So we're here with this incredible Mantellisaurus skeleton, which is one of the most complete dinosaur skeletons ever discovered in the UK. It was found in 1914, which just so happens to be during the lifetime of Franz Nopcsa. Now, Nopcsa was a geologist and paleontologist born in what is now Transylvania in Romania. During his lifetime, he was considered something of a rock star scientist. He lived the life of a dandy, traveling around Europe on a motorcycle with his partner, and he even became a wartime spy. He was also openly and somewhat flamboyantly gay. Today, Nopcsa is considered by many as the father of what is called paleobiology, as he started to look at these long extinct animals, not just at their appearance and what they looked like, but he started to think about how they lived and behaved and interacted as living, breathing creatures. Nopcsa's life is really quite an astonishing one. He was born into Austro-Hungarian aristocracy and studied geology at the University of Vienna. Over his lifetime, he had an extraordinary career, publishing over 150 scientific papers on everything ranging from the geology of Romania and Albania to miniature dinosaurs that once lived in the area during the Cretaceous. Now, Nopcsa's status allowed him to be openly gay at a time when it was still very much illegal. And he had a long-term partnership with a man called Bajazet Doda. Together, they would travel Europe quite extensively over a period of 30 years. Now, Nopcsa had a deep love for the country of Albania, and in fact, he was one of the first outsiders to really explore and document the life in the northern mountains of the country, which up until that time had been completely inaccessible and completely cut off to any outsiders. Along with Doda, they extensively documented the life and cultures of the villagers, even at some point being kidnapped by bandits and having to be released by Doda's father. Nopcsa doted so much on Doda that he even named a species of fossil turtle Calicobotian Bajazidae, which has been translated as the beautiful box of Bajazid, and is thought to be a reference from Nopcsa about Doda's rather shapely bottom. Now, Nopcsa was also the first person to try and sex a dinosaur, which is a surprisingly tricky thing to do. He thought that he had discovered differences between various fossils of ceratopsians, which are the large horned dinosaurs such as Triceratops. He thought that he could find both male and female fossils, and whilst ultimately he was proven to be wrong and that it turns out that these were completely separate species, he was the first person to actually start thinking about how differences in skeletons and how differences in bones could actually be related to sex. And that is something that even today scientists and paleontologists have to take into account when they find a new fossil animal. As I mentioned, he was a really prolific scientist. He published over 150 papers on a whole range of topics, but in the end, he died a really tragic death and faded into obscurity. So here we are next to this really quite amazing 300 kilogram turbinara coral, which was first collected over 120 years ago in Shark Bay in Western Australia. When it was alive, it would have been host to a whole range of species of invertebrates and fish. And what is really interesting is that when you look at a coral reef, up to a third of all species of fish swimming around are either a sequential or a simultaneous hermaphrodite. This means individual bodies that are producing both the large and the small gametes. Now, a simultaneous hermaphrodite is an individual which produces both the large and small at the same time within their own bodies, while a sequential is one, as you might have guessed by now, produces them one after the other. So, for example, there is a type of fish called the hamlet, which is a simultaneous hermaphrodite. So when they mate, one individual will produce the sperm and another individual will produce the eggs. But after a few minutes, they will swap. So the individual that was producing the sperm will now be producing the eggs, and the individual that's producing the eggs will now be producing the sperm. There is another species of fish called the blunt-headed wrasse, which is a sequential hermaphrodite, as females will change sex into males and compete with those individuals that started off life as males. What is interesting here is that whether or not females change to become male depends entirely on the environment and the situation in which they find themselves in, which goes to show that these abilities to change your sex and to change their own body is environmentally determined rather than something that is genetically determined. Finally, there's a third species I'd like to talk about, which is the Okinawa goby. Now, this fish starts off life as unsexed juveniles. They'll drift down and land on a piece of coral. They'll form monogamous pairs with one individual becoming the male and one individual becoming the female. But then sometimes, at some point in their life, they all swap sexes. So obviously the male becomes the female and the female becomes the male. What's even more extraordinary is that in some of these pairs, they will then go on to swap sexes again for what will become the third time in their lives. Now, it's not just fish in coral reefs that are hermaphroditic, as many of the marine invertebrates that also live in and amongst the corals also behave this way. It just goes to show how common this is under the waves. So life histories like this question our own notion of binary sex and how other animals organize their bodies in the natural world. So next up, we're here next to this astonishingly beautiful case showcasing the incredible diversity of the insect world. Because, rather incredibly, the first known image of same-sex sexual behavior is actually a drawing from 1896 of two male cockchafer beetles. The irony of that is certainly not lost. Our story begins in the 19th century, when there was actually quite a lot of interest among entomologists on same-sex behavior in insects, after the German naturalist August Kelch described two male cockchafer beetles having sex in 1834. This triggered a whole series of debates about the natural world and about whether homosexuality amongst the insects was natural and whether that actually meant that homosexuality among men was natural at a time when it was still very much illegal. Many scientists tried to come up with ways to explain away the behavior. Some said that the male beetles were probably confused, something that many of us have probably heard ourselves. Others said that the beetles were probably blind, whilst others claimed that it was simply a case that there were no other female beetles around, so the males were just getting on with it. But in 1879, Russian entomologist Carl Robert Olsen Sacken actually wrote that the beetles were engaging in sex willingly and not under mitigating circumstances, which was an incredibly controversial statement at the time. A year later, the naturalist Karl Heinrich Ulrich would list virtually the entire entomological record of same-sex behavior in the insect world in order to justify homosexuality amongst humans. Unfortunately, this was taken by many others and twisted in order to prove that such degenerate behavior was in fact hereditary, which was feeding into the growing notion of eugenics that was developing at the time. Finally, it would not be until 1896, a full 62 years after this behavior was first described, that the image of two male cockchafer beetles appeared in a paper by Henry Godeau de Kerville. He argued that this behavior was natural even in higher vertebrates, which is presumably a rare reference to humans. Unfortunately, as was common with the time, Godeau de Kerville was roundly denounced by those who wanted to protect the status quo. Many of us may know Charles Darwin for his theory of natural selection, which explains how new species emerge due to the environment. But he was also interested in some seemingly counterintuitive traits, such as the tail of a peacock. To explain this, he developed a second theory, that of sexual selection. In this, he argued that it was not the environment that was influencing the evolution of the males, but it was the females choosing the biggest and the flashiest. As each successive generation went forward, only the biggest, brightest, most aggressive males would survive. This theory is problematic in a number of ways, not least because he repeatedly reinforces this notion of the aggressive male and the coy female, which is a stereotype that still persists even to this day. But he also made one glaring omission, in that he failed to account for same-sex sexual behaviors. The theory is also overwhelmingly heteronormative, in that one of its central tenets assumes that the only reason for sex is reproduction, something which we all know is not necessarily true. And Darwin seemingly knew this was the case. And while these ideas were picked up and expanded on by later researchers, Darwin himself seemingly worked around the issues, including that of homosexuality, despite mentioning various sex variations within his own works. But also, his theory of sexual selection doesn't account for when these roles are reversed. So, for example, there's the jacana bird, in which the females are the dominant of the pair and control one territory of multiple males. Okay, so now let's go up to the pheasant case where we can talk about some ancient Greeks. Okay, so now we're at this beautiful case showing the amazing variety and diversity of pheasants, which is really interesting because some of the first observations of LGBTQ plus animals was actually in pheasants and hens. Some of the earliest references to queer nature is actually from Aristotle, who wrote specifically about sex-changing birds, but would more readily and more accurately be described as females presenting as males and vice versa. Aristotle specifically wrote about female hens presenting as males, not just in appearance, but also in behavior. Over the centuries, these sex-reversed birds allowed many scientists and naturalists to explore subjects that were typically seen as taboo, such as homosexuality, but also the ability for animals to change their observed sex. One of the most significant contributions was a paper titled An Account of an Extraordinary Pheasant by the Scottish naturalist John Hunter in 1780. In this, he talks about sex-changing pheasants and peahens and uses it to explore humans as well. But more significantly, he also starts talking about secondary properties. Now, Hunter's work wasn't really picked up on or expanded on until the English naturalist William Yarrell started talking about it in 1827. Yarrell developed it and actually suggested that it wasn't just older birds that had this ability to change their plumage, but could also be done by younger ones. If any of this sounds familiar, it's because Yarrell's and Hunter's work is one of the cornerstones of Darwin's theory of sexual selection, particularly the notion of the secondary sexual characteristics and the notion that within the body there is the ability to change. This all helped to feed into this idea of the mutability of characteristics and later genes, which is what behind the entire process of evolution itself. Right, next up, we're going to go and see Richard Owen, who is just around the corner. We're about halfway through the tour at this point, so if you've had enough, then you can duck out. But there's still plenty more to see, from Guy the Gorilla to queer penguins and hyenas. Let's keep going, shall we? So here we are with the statue of Richard Owen, who actually founded this very building. And as you saw with Darwin, just down below, there are very few statues of people in the museum, but there used to be one more that is no longer on display. You see, in 1901, the second director of the museum, a man named called Professor Ray Lankester, actually commissioned the naked statue of the Victorian bodybuilder Eugene Sandow to put on display. Sandow was a international celebrity and eventually a very highly regarded sex symbol in Victorian times. He started out as a strongman and then later became what many regard as the first professional bodybuilder. Sandow modeled his body and his chiseled physique on that of the ancient Greeks and was widely regarded by both men and women in Victorian England at the time. Sandow found ways to further capitalize on this obsession with the human body of the time when he transitioned from performing on the circuit's act of strength to actually transitioning and moving into posing as an art form. He even had a specially designed posing box made where the lights were at the correct angle to highlight all of his bulging muscles. He would flex and pose in nothing more than his leopard skin loincloth. Undoubtedly, there was a sexual element to all of this as he moved from being admired for his strength to adored for his looks. In fact, he had fans, both men and women, who would pay to come backstage after his performance and to finger his muscles, as one writer once put it. And one of these admirers was Ray Lankester, and he went on to commission this statue at fairly considerable cost to the museum and time to put on display. When it went on display, despite Ray Lankester being incredibly proud of what he'd done, it was met with almost revulsion as the press and the public described it as something of a monstrosity. It was also deemed to be quite explicit because it was fully naked, and after just a few months, they had to commission a fig leaf to be placed on the statue to cover his modesty, and eventually, after just 3 months on display in 1901, the statue was relegated to the basement. That wasn't until the 1990s when a certain Mr. Arnold Schwarzenegger, who admired Sandow for being the father of bodybuilding, got in contact with the museum and actually asked for the statue to be recast so he could add it to his own private collection. Right, now let's go on and see Guy the Gorilla. It it'll probably come as no surprise that many species of ape frequently show homosexual behavior. So for example, with female gorillas, they can form intense friendships with other females in the harem, during which they will engage in touching and grooming and lying with their friend or their partner. They will also can engage fairly frequently in queer sex as well, in which the females will rub their genitals together and lie face to face, which, quite interestingly, is more intimate than when they have sex with another male. And, even more interestingly, quite often lasts longer too. Female gorillas aren't alone in doing this though. Male gorillas will often form bachelor groups in which multiple males live together for an extended period of time. And during this, and within these groups, there are quite often a complex network of queer partnering. So some males will partner up with another male and remain monogamous and exclusive, effectively, to their partner, but others will be a bit more free and easy. Interestingly, there can also be intense competition for those who are deemed the best partners, with the dominant males aggressively defending the male which they have chosen to partner up with. As with the females, they will also groom each other and touch each other and will also engage in sex. And again, they will have sex not only back to front, but also front to front. And in a similar way with the females, it will also last longer than when they normally have heterosexual sex. When it comes to these behaviours, they are often frequently explained away as being either playing or fighting, or they will be termed in ways in which they talk about these being aggressive or dominance displays. But as is common with these behaviours, they are often biased by our own assumptions, with many scientific papers, even in modern times, describing this behaviour as either maladaptive or paradoxical and abhorrent. Obviously, these terms are incredibly morally loaded. I mean, how, for example, would these behaviours be so common and persist throughout hundreds, thousands of species if it was somehow maladaptive or paradoxical? Taking things back to sexual selection, and one of the assumptions within that theory, again, assumes that the genital architecture of many, if not most, animals is also driven by the opposite sex. But one primatologist called Franz Nopcsa, who studied bonobos, instead suggested that within the bonobo ape, which is a close cousin of the chimpanzee, the genital architecture of the females was in fact driven by other females because homosexual sex was so common. He argued that the position of the clitoris was better stimulated when an individual was having sex with another female than with another male, suggesting that this may be the primary cause for the way that the vagina of the bonobo looks the way it does. Right, on that note, should we crack on? So scientists have been documenting homosexual behaviour in a range of penguin species for over a century now. Popular in many zoos and aquariums, queer Humboldt penguins regularly make the news as they adopt and raise chicks of their own. In fact, it's thought that within zoos, up to maybe 5% of all penguin pairings are homosexual. But it's not just in captivity that penguins display this queer behaviour. Dr. George Murray-Levick was a ship surgeon and scientist and photographer on the Scott's Antarctic expedition in 1912. And he was in fact the first person to observe a full breeding cycle of the Adélie penguin. During this time, he saw all sorts of behaviors and interesting facts about these birds, but he also saw what he and others deemed obscene and disturbing behaviors, including homosexuality. On returning to the UK, Levick tried to get his papers on this full breeding cycle published, including not only section on sexual activity, including the queer behavior, but also forced copulation and necrophilia, but it was rejected. The section of the paper on sexual activities was actually excised from the final edition, and those parts dealing with the sexual behaviors were printed separately and distributed to a select number of people. This episode goes to show just how the behaviours such as homosexuality were treated at the time, that they were not deemed acceptable for the general public to view and only allowed for an elite select number of scientists to look at the time. It was not until one of these documents containing Levick's work was discovered by accident at the Natural History Museum in Tring that the full range of Adélie sexual behaviours became known more widely. and was finally published in 2012, a full 100 years after Levick first observed them. Right, so next up, we're off to the swans, which is just down here. So here we are next to a pair of rather lovely swans. And in fact, the first ever photograph of any homosexual animals was of a pair of two male nesting mute swans on a loch in Scotland in 1923. In fact, homosexual swans and queer swans can help us question this very persistent notion in biology that somehow homosexual behavior is maladaptive, because in actual fact, homosexual pairings of swans are often more successful at raising chicks than their heterosexual counterparts. Both male and female swans have been found to show homosexual behavior, but for some reason it is quite persistent within male Australian black swans. They've been found to form stable, long-lasting relationships with each other and even perform courtship dances. A gay couple will occasionally mate with a female in order to get some eggs, or they will even chase off a heterosexual pair from their nest and steal everything, including the eggs, within it. The gay pair will then incubate the clutch, hatch the eggs, and then raise the chicks. And in fact, homosexual pairs are often far more successful in raising chicks than the heterosexual pairs. The success rate for queer couples are around 80%, whilst for the heterosexual couples, it's only around 30%. This is thought to be because the pair of males can defend a much larger territory, typically, than the heterosexual couple, and also because the homosexual pair will share the incubation duties far more evenly than between males and females. This is super interesting because it seems to counter the idea that somehow homosexual relationships are against natural selection, because in actual fact, the homosexual pairs will raise and produce more offspring. So here we are with this rather fabulous sheep skull. Because as we've been talking about throughout this tour, we frequently refer to animals as being queer, gay, or lesbian, but that is a fascinating question in and of itself. Can an animal actually be gay? These terms are more commonly used to refer to people because they refer not just to the act itself, but to sexuality as a whole. And obviously, we can't ask animals, so we don't actually know what sexuality they are. And if we're being honest anyway, then they probably wouldn't be gay because they have sex with all different sexes. But there is one species which has shown, alongside humans, to have a consistent preference for other males, and that is the domestic sheep, such as this one. In studies, they have found that up to 10% of rams will show a consistent preference for other males, even when given the option of a female in heat. This indicates that perhaps some sheep are actually homosexual, although, as I just said, there is no way to say this definitively because obviously we can't talk to them. What's really interesting is that when you even look into some populations of wild sheep, they too show this whole range of homosexual behavior. So for example, in the bighorn sheep of North America, dominant males will quite often court, mount, and even penetrate younger males. And this behavior is so almost ingrained in these populations that even females in heat will emulate the behavior of younger males in order to encourage the older rams to mount them. Why this behavior is so predominant in sheep isn't really well known, but it could be similar to the hens and pheasants in that simply as humans we've been observing them and keeping them for a lot longer and so have noticed this behavior more frequently than with other animals. On that note, let's go and look at the hyenas. Okay, so here we are with the hyenas, because female hyenas actually have a penis-like structure that can make them incredibly difficult to tell apart visually from males. In fact, it used to be thought that hyenas were hermaphrodites because it was so difficult to tell the sexes apart. This structure is in actual fact the female's clitoris, which has become elongated so that it can be up to 7 inches long and can even be fully erect. In addition to that, their labia has fused to form something like a scrotum and is filled with connective tissue and fat that make them look like fully formed testes. This means that female hyenas have to urinate have sex and even give birth through this structure. And even heterosexual sex is a complicated affair, as the females effectively have to retract their clitoris in order to allow for copulation. Giving birth is also incredibly risky, because it has to, in effect, take place through their clitoris and can be often fatal for both the mother and the infant. Spotted hyenas live in a matrilineal society, which means that females are the dominant out of the group and can live in clans of up to 80. And the females will also frequently engage in queer and lesbian behavior, in which they will flick their erect penis-like structure against their belly, which is a sign of sexual arousal. They will lick each other's genitals, and they will even mount each other. Now, unfortunately, that's all we've got time for today. We really hope that you enjoyed the Natural History Museum's LGBTQ plus tour. And if you did, then be sure to check out more of our video content. Alternatively, you can subscribe to the channel for more films and live broadcasts on the natural world, or you can check out more information on our website. The address is linked in the description below. Thank you so much.